We're getting back into our series today. Last week we took a little hiatus because Peter Warren shared on prayer last week, which was really good. But today we're going to get back into our series, our April series, which is called A Moment of Truth. And if you missed it the first week, let me just explain it to you real quick. I came up with a definition for it to help give some context. Moments of truth are critical moments that test and reveal our true self and forces us to face the truth in our life. These things basically happen in our life and they reveal what we really care about, and in our faith they actually reveal what we really believe too. These things are moments of truth, are all through life, in our personal life, they're all through the Bible. Pretty much every person, every character you'll see in your Bible came upon these moments of truth where they had to decide what they were going to do, what they were going to believe, and how they were going to respond to it. I mean, from Adam and Eve to Moses and Noah and Joseph and Jacob and Peter and John the Baptist, all the disciples, and even Jesus himself had moments of truth that we see in Scripture. So these things are important that we recognize them. And what we're going to do over these next couple weeks, we're going to look at God's design for them and how we can set ourselves up to succeed when we come to these moments of truth, but also to find God's grace when we fail in these moments too. So I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to today. I enjoyed first service, and I think you're going to be blessed in this service as well. I want to jump right into my text because I have a lot to say today. I have a lot of words. And my text today is going to be out of John 10. So if you have your Bible, you can turn there. If you don't have a Bible, we will put it up on the screen as well for you here in a moment. John 10, Jesus was in his ministry at this time, his earthly ministry. He was roaming the earth and he was healing and doing all kinds of great stuff. But the religious people of the day did not like Jesus. He really he was like a pebble in their shoe or in their sandal. They did not like him. And in John 10 here, we see a little confrontation he had with the religious people. So I'm going to start reading in verse 22. If you would stand with me, please, as we read God's word together in honor of his word. I'm going to read through verse 27. It says, "Then came the feast of dedication at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was in the temple area walking in Solomon's colonnade. The Jews gathered around him saying, 'How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly.' Jesus answered them, 'I did tell you, but you do not believe. The miracles I do in my Father's name speak for me, but you do not believe because you are not my sheep.'" And here's my text for the day. "My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me." The title of my message today is "Let His Voice Be Heard." I'm going to talk to you today about hearing the voice of the Lord. Would you pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we do love you. Thank you for this time together. Thank you for a sweet time of worshiping you, God, with music and song. And I pray, God, that our worship would continue even in these next few moments, God, as we just trust you. I pray that you would move in our midst, move among us, in our hearts, and that you would do what only you can do in each one of our lives, God. And let it be for your glory, and let it be for our good. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. God bless you. You can be seated. So, hearing the voice of God. You know, we can hear God's voice in our life. Hearing the voice of the Lord is one of the most wanted and also one of the most misunderstood aspects of the Christian faith. There's a whole spectrum of what people think about when we talk about hearing the voice of God. There's all the way over here where we really mystify it and complicate it, all the way to the other side where we almost oversimplify it and actually belittle it a little bit. But no matter where you fall on the spectrum, pretty much all of us would agree, if you are a follower of Jesus, you want to hear from God. We want to hear God's voice in our life. But part of the problem with hearing the voice of the Lord is that if you're like me, you immediately, when you think of that term, you think of hearing, you automatically go to your ears. Because everything else I hear in life, whether it's a sound or if it's from a person, everything I hear is with my ears. And I can distinguish what I hear based on my relationship with that person. If I'm in a room full of 100, with 100 people in it, and the only person I know in the room is Joy, well, I'm gonna be able to hear her voice. I'm gonna be able to distinguish her voice above all those other 99 because I know her, right? And that's what Jesus is saying here, is that my sheep listen to my voice. But we want to hear with our ear, but oftentimes that's not how God actually speaks to us. Very few people have heard the audible voice of God. Most of the time he speaks to us in different ways, but he does speak in our life. Most oftentimes he'll speak to us through, sometimes through our spirit, you know, where the Bible says in Romans that his spirit testifies with our spirit. So if you are a follower of Jesus, if you are a Christian today, then you have the Spirit of God in you, and that Spirit testifies and speaks to us and confirms things in our life and shows us, gives us direction in our life. He also speaks to us through our eyes, through reading, because we read his word. God speaks to us through his word all the time. But guess how he doesn't speak to us through his word? When we don't read it. We have to be in the word to be able to hear his voice in us through his word. All of you, if you read your Bible, you know there have been times where you've read it and you've had something jump out at you, and it's as if God spoke it to you audibly, as if it was written there just for you for that moment in time. God speaks to us through our eyes when we read. He also speaks to us through understanding. This is so good because in Proverbs, it talks about the fact that from his mouth come knowledge and understanding and wisdom. So that's one of the ways God speaks, is to give understanding and wisdom. And you probably experienced that in your life, where because you've grown in your faith, you've encountered experiences where the wisdom of God kept you from doing something that you would have regretted. And that's God speaking to you. It's him giving you wisdom. He also speaks through circumstances. That's actually a very practical way that God speaks to us, is through the things that happen to us, where a lot of times it's not until hindsight that we actually see that it was God speaking to us, but it was him. Where you'll have a situation that you'll realize, oh man, that had to have been God because of this, this, and this. There's a situation that happened to me and Joy actually a long, long time ago where God spoke to me through a circumstance. And it was really incredible, actually. This was about 25 years ago. So I was in my mid-20s. We weren't even married yet. In fact, I don't even know if we were dating. We might have been broken up. We hung out more when we were broken up than we did when we were dating. That's a whole story, but that was all before we were married. We hang out more now that we're married, so that's good. But anyway, we're driving up I-25 in Colorado, and it's nighttime, it's dark, it's raining, and I can't even see her beside me to see if she had her seatbelt on, but something inside of me prompted me to ask her, are you wearing your seatbelt? And she said, no, actually I'm not. And I said, well, would you mind putting it on? And she said, sure, no problem. That's how our relationship is. I just ask her stuff and she just complies. It's just, it's really nice. I don't understand why you guys have trouble with this. You laugh like you don't believe me. Anyway, and this time though, she did actually. She put it on and I didn't think anything of it. 3 minutes later, out of nowhere, I don't know if we hit a puddle or if we hit black ice or what it was, but just out of nowhere, all of a sudden my car just lost control and I spun around 3 times in the middle of the interstate. And you know, the fact that I asked her to put her seatbelt on, it wasn't because I was afraid. It wasn't because there was anything that I thought, oh, I sense this imminent fear or this imminent trouble that's gonna happen. In fact, when I was 25, I would have ranked myself in the top 5 of drivers in the world. I thought I had perfect control of my vehicle. I was bulletproof. And if you were with me, you were lucky because you were bulletproof now too. And so me asking her to do that had nothing to do with any outside situation. But we spun around and we came to a stop facing the wrong direction. I had to actually turn around. And it was a scary thing because we were probably doing 70 miles an hour up I-25. The crazy thing about this was, on the first or second rotation, her car door flew wide open. Right in the middle of it. The car was locked. The doors were fine. It wasn't a beat up car at all. The door just swung wide open right as we were spinning around one of the times. And it was incredible because in that moment, I realized, wow, that was God speaking to me to tell her to put her seatbelt on. I recognized it. And it was the circumstance that happened that made me recognize it, because if we had never had that accident, we just drove and I dropped her off at home and never thought about it again, we would never ever, we wouldn't even remember that I asked her to put her seatbelt on, because nothing would have happened. But because of the circumstance, I realized, oh, that was God speaking to us. And that's what he does in our life. He will prompt us. He'll give us something. We'll do something. We think it's us in the moment. But if you have ears to hear and eyes to see, you can actually see that it's God speaking in your life. He speaks to us all different kinds of ways. And the reality is he's speaking to us all the time. And every time he does, it's a moment of truth for you and me. Because we have to decide how we're going to respond. Am I going to recognize it as him? And if I do, am I going to listen to what he said? And am I going to act on it and obey? It's a moment of truth. We have to decide, are we going to follow him? Because see, the enemy would want you to think that you can't hear God. The enemy of your soul would want you to think, nah, that's just for the super spiritual. That's just for the super Christian, the very charismatics, the ones with the gift that can, you know, has the gift of prophecy. can hear God and be an orator for God. It's those people. You have to have a seminary degree to be able to really hear the voice of God. You have to be a pastor. You have to be somebody on a stage with a microphone. Those are the ones that can hear the voice of God. Can I tell you today, the fact that I'm a pastor doesn't let me hear the voice of God any more than does anybody else. In fact, the majority of the times that God has spoken to me, that I've known God has spoken to my heart and caused me to make life-altering decisions, most of those situations happened long before I was a pastor, before I had a title. We're the ones that give titles and put importance on that. God calls us sheep. We are the sheep of his pasture. And my sheep listen to me. My sheep listen and follow me. And so the fact that I have a title doesn't make me any more able to hear from God than anybody else. But the enemy wants you to think that that's how it works. And that it can even seem a little humble on our part to say, oh, I'm just a lowly Christian. You know, God's not going to speak to me. And it can almost sound noble in a way. But can I tell you, it's a lie from the pit of hell that's meant to keep you down. And because what it does, when you don't think you can hear from God, what that does is that hinders you and keeps you from even believing you can or even trying. And so what happens to us is that we sit around and we wait to be spoon-fed the words of God. Oh, I can only hear from God if I'm, you know, if a pastor says something that sounds really cool and rings in my ears. I can only hear from God if someone comes up to me and says, hey, thus saith the Lord, ... whatever. I can only hear from God if somebody else that can hear God speaks it to me. And it hinders us, it cripples us in our faith. And it's a lie from your enemy who would want to keep you from having that in your life. My text says that my sheep listen to my voice. My sheep, and it's very clear in scripture that if you are a follower of Jesus, you are one of his sheep. So you can hear, you know, some versions say that my sheep hear me. But I like this version because listening to me in this context is more appropriate in the English. Because to hear something, you know, I can hear something and not really be listening, right? If I'm watching TV and Joy's talking to me, I'm hearing her, but I'm probably not listening, especially if it's something I'm really interested in on the television. Ladies, men are just really good at this. You guys wouldn't know anything about it, but we are good at acting like we're listening, but we're really not. It's going in the ear canal and rattling around in there, but you can hear things, but not necessarily listen. This word listen here that Jesus uses actually means to pay attention. It means to take it in, to give ear to it, to consider it. I love it. It also means to tune in. That's what Jesus is saying here. He says, my sheep tune in. My sheep consider my words. My sheep make sure they're paying attention. They're not just being distracted by everything else, but they're actually paying attention. So this is actually really good because if you want to know, am I a sheep of Jesus? Is he my shepherd? Are you listening? Are you tuning in? Not just when you need something, church. Not just when life is crazy and chaotic and you really need God to do something, but are you tuning in daily? Are you listening to him? Are you paying attention? Or is it just kind of like noise that's happening? You know, you hear somebody talk about God. Maybe you read your Bible when you need something from him. But other than that, it's just kind of like it's almost culture more than it is really tuning in to who God is and what he's wanting to say to you. Because Jesus says, my sheep will tune in. My sheep will listen. They will hear what I have to say. There's a great example of this in 1 Samuel. Samuel, if you don't know, he was the last judge of Israel before they started having kings. And when he was still a child, he was living in the temple. His parents gave him and dedicated him at the temple, and he served Eli, the priest, in his childhood. And when he was around 12 years old is what most scholars think this happened, where he was laying down one night, and he heard a voice say, Samuel, Samuel. And he thought it was Eli. So he gets up, goes over to Eli's room, and he says, yes, I'm here. And Eli says, I didn't call you, son. Go back to bed. So he goes back, lays down again, hears it again. Goes back to Eli. Yeah, here I am. And Eli says, son, I had not tell you to come here. Sounds like my kids at night sometimes. But anyway, he goes back, happens a third time. And by the third time, Eli's figured it out. He realized God's speaking to Samuel. So he says, listen, next time, go back, lay down. If you hear it again, tell him, speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. So then in 1 Samuel 3, verse 10, it says he goes back, and here's what it says. It says, the Lord came and stood there, calling as at other times. So he did the exact same thing he did the first three times. Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel said, speak, for your servant is listening. Your servant is tuned in. I'm giving ear. I'm considering what you're saying. It's so cool here because nothing different happened the fourth time from the first three, except Samuel was ready. He was listening. He didn't just hear it like he did the first three times. Now he's tuned in. And God gives him this long message and tells him what he's going to do in Israel and what he's going to do through Samuel. And it was this whole thing. But God had to wait until Samuel was actually listening before he could actually speak the message he wanted to give to him. There's a strong pull for us to hear God speak. And that's a good thing. God put that in us for us to want to hear him because he wants to speak to us. But it is oftentimes very subtle. Virtually all of us probably have it at or near the top of our list of things we want from God because we want to hear from him. Because we know that when he speaks, he gives direction. He gives encouragement. He gives us information sometimes. He strengthens us. Man, there's nothing like knowing that you've heard from God. Nothing like it. But if we're honest, I think it can be easy for us sometimes to feel like, I want to hear the voice of God in my life. I want to hear him speak to me because it'll make my life easier. If God would only speak. If God would speak into this circumstance, I'm sure that it would instantly be better. And you know what? Sometimes that is the case. Sometimes he'll speak into a situation and he'll, when his word comes in, if nothing else, it changes your perspective, which is good. But here's the truth that we have to understand. And part of the reason I came to talk to you today was to encourage us and to remind us and teach for some of us that when God speaks, it's not necessarily that the situation is going to get better right away. In fact, oftentimes when God speaks, it's actually to sustain us. Because many times when he speaks, it's actually going to get worse before it gets better. That's not necessarily the plan of God in our life. Sometimes it is. But when he speaks, it's because God knows the future from the beginning. He knows it all. So he'll speak to sustain us until whatever that promise is, whatever he has showed you is going to happen in the future, happens. I mean, I know it personally in my life more times than I can possibly share in one message. I've seen it all through the Bible. It's so many times in the Bible, I couldn't count them all. But just to give you a couple real quick, Joseph. You see, in Genesis, Joseph is one of the sons of Jacob. And God gives him a vision, speaks to him through a dream, and says, and shows him that his brothers and his parents are all going to be bowing down to him. He's going to be a ruler. And he was just, Joseph was nobody. And he gets so excited, he goes and tells his family. Probably shouldn't have done that because it didn't go well for him. But eventually it got to the place where he was the ruler. He was second in charge in Egypt. But from the time he got that promise from God till that happened, he went through a living hell. He went through a lot. You look at the children of Israel as they were slaves in Egypt, and God calls Moses and says, hey, I'm going to deliver these people. I'm tired of their suffering. I'm going to deliver them out of Egypt. And Moses goes and tells the elders of Israel, and they're excited. They're like, thank God, finally. And then Moses goes and tells Pharaoh, hey, let our people go. And Pharaoh gets mad. He says, you guys only want to go because you're lazy. I need to put more work on you. So he loads them down with more work. And God comes back to Moses and reassures him, hey, I'm going to deliver them. So Moses goes back to the elders again to reassure them. And look what the elders said when he came to them the second time in Exodus 6:9. It says Moses reported this to the Israelites, but they did not listen to him because of their discouragement and cruel bondage. It actually got worse after the Lord spoke to them before it got better. Now, it got better. It got a lot better. But a lot of times the word of God for us is to sustain us. I can tell you in my own personal life, I've shared it from here before about how I knew that the Lord spoke to my heart 5 years before I started pastoring this church. 5 years the Lord spoke to me and said that I was going to be pastoring this church. And Joy and I really didn't tell many people. We told a couple very close friends to us, and that was it. And I knew it was the Lord because I feel like I know when the Lord speaks to my heart, when he shows me stuff. And one of the reasons I knew was because I wasn't even looking for it. It wasn't even something I was aiming for. I didn't have goals set for this. I was happy to serve the Lord in any capacity. And so when he shared this, you know, my thought immediately was like, oh, okay, that's cool. So we'll just, you know, we'll progressively get to that place and eventually, boop, we'll just, everything will just be smooth and easy. It took 5 years from that moment. And I could tell you 4 of those 5 years were 4 of the hardest years of my life. And I look back now and I see the Lord actually gave me that and showed me that to sustain me because it was going to get worse before it got better. There's a lot of factors involved in that that don't need to be shared, but the reality is I know in my personal life that that's exactly what the Lord was showing me. Let me speak to some of the single people here. Some of you that are single and you feel like, you know you want to be married, you want to have kids, you want to have a family, young people especially. And maybe the Lord has spoken to you and said, hey, you're going to get married one day and it's going to be great, it's going to be wonderful, and you've got this promise. Somebody prophesied it to you. You read something in the Word that just you knew it was for you. And the tendency for us can be when we get something like that to think, okay, tomorrow I got to have a really good hair day because obviously I'm going to meet him tomorrow. And we're going to fall madly in love and everything's going to be amazing and it's going to be this incredible experience. But the reality is oftentimes God shows us stuff like that because you're going to go through a season where it's going to feel like you're never going to get married. And you need that word from God to sustain you till you get to that place to where it's fulfilled. Happens all the time. If we went around the room, most of us could share stories of how God spoke to us and man, it got really nasty for a minute and before it actually happened. Because God's word is meant to sustain us in our life. But probably one of the biggest issues that we as Christians deal with when it comes to hearing the voice of God is feeling like I can't hear God. You know, the question I hear constantly is, why can't I hear the voice of the Lord? You know, I feel like I'm tuned in. I feel like I'm listening. I feel like I'm doing what I know to do, but I feel like I'm the only one that doesn't hear from God. Everybody else, you know, has his contact info in their phone and can call him anytime they want. And I just can't hear from him no matter what I do. I fast, I pray, I read, I do all this stuff. I can't hear from God. I think all of us probably dealt with that to some degree. And the reality of it is that life is about seasons. Your faith is about seasons. There will be times and there will be seasons where you'll feel like you'll have a moment like on the interstate where God spoke so clearly and showed me. And when he talked to us about pastoring the church, and there's a lot of times like that, but there's also times that it's really, really subtle. And you almost don't see it in the moment until in hindsight. But then there is times where it feels like, man, I don't feel like God's speaking to me. I don't feel like I'm just not being stirred. Even when I read my Bible, it just feels like words on a page. And why can't I get back to that time where, you know, when I would sit down and read my Bible, I couldn't wait because I could just feel like, man, God was just going to impart some great wisdom in me and I was going to be excited and on fire. It's going to be wonderful. But there are seasons. But there's also things that we can allow into our life that can hinder us from hearing him. Because there is things that we can slowly drift into places where we're almost causing the lines to be shut, the lines to be cut. And I want to talk to you about a few of these. This will be the rest of the body of my message today. I want to give you these three things that I feel like the Lord showed me that can really hinder us from hearing the voice of God, okay? And they all start with I, so it'll be easy to remember. And that really wasn't intentional, it just kind of happened. And the first one is inauthenticity. Inauthenticity, that's a long word. Obviously, it means not being authentic. You know, one of the biggest messages in your Bible, one of the strongest messages is that God responds to sincere hearts. God responds to sincere hearts, the opposite of being inauthentic. He doesn't want religion. He doesn't want ritual. He died so that he could have relationship, real relationship with you. That's what he wants. That's what he responds to in our life. And you know, it's funny because we would all say the churchy answer for the question is like, who can you be the most real with in your life? We would all say, oh, it's God. I can be the most real with him, right? Yet oftentimes he's the one we're the least real with. Why is it that we can turn into something different or somebody different when we're talking to God? You know, some of us have a regular voice and then we have a prayer voice. My grandpa had a prayer voice. When he prayed, he talked in almost like a different language. It's like he started talking King James. And I never heard him talk like that in regular, you know, so it was kind of confusing. But we can even do that where we're not really being authentic. We're kind of doing something that we think, well, this is probably what God wants. But we're really not letting our heart show. We're kind of disguising ourselves. And we'll complain to anyone and everyone that will listen to us. But when we talk to God, it's, oh, God, I just thank you that you're amazing and I love you and you're awesome and thank you for loving me. And we kind of go through this ritualistic thing almost rather than really laying our heart bare before God, which is what he wants. You know, the Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. And David laid his heart bare. You look at the Psalms, you see all kinds of Psalms where David is really getting up in his fields. And he's just laying it out there. And God responds to it. In fact, One of the more popular ones is Psalm 13, where we see David really sharing how he's feeling about a situation. He says, "Oh Lord, how long will you forget me? Forever?" The Lord didn't forget David, and he knew it. But he was allowing himself to be real with God. "How long will you look the other way? How long must I struggle with anguish in my soul, with sorrow in my heart every day? How long will my enemy have the upper hand? Turn and answer me, O Lord my God. Restore the sparkle to my eyes, or I will die." You know, this isn't a prayer you hear very often in the church today, because it's not proper, right? It's not proper. That's a little bit too raw. Yet David, a man after God's own heart, prayed this. Church, this could set some of us free today. To know that God doesn't care about my perfect words. He doesn't care about making sure I know exactly how I'm supposed to pray. He wants our heart. He wants us to come to him like the way we are. And the way you are is the way you are. You're not the other person on the end of the aisle. You're not the other person in your house. You are you. And he wants you to be real. What I can tell you today is that God doesn't need or want your manicured prayers. I'm telling you, the first time I got a hold of this, it set me free. Because I grew up very, very structured. And it had to look a certain way and be a certain way. God wants authenticity. He wants your heart. Sometimes we need to say, "How long, Lord? Why have you turned your back on me? Why have you forgotten me? Why don't I feel anything?" God responds to that. God wants that from us. He wants us to be real. Now, I'm not suggesting we just whine and complain all day long to God and just turn into three-year-olds. Because we also, there's an aspect of being authentic that also know where you know your place. Being authentic is about knowing your place in your relationship with God. And David, though he did vent and whine and complain, I love how he finished off this psalm. The last two verses, he says, "But I trust in your unfailing love. I will rejoice because you have rescued me. I will sing to the Lord because he is good to me." See, this journey, we go on these journeys with God. But the journey is meant to purify our motives. It's meant to bring us to a place of really being able to be real, but be pure before God too. Because see, sometimes we just want to hear the voice of the Lord because we want it for ourselves. Don't necessarily care that God gets honored or glorified in it. I just want relief for myself. And we just have, and we can even think that that's not that big a deal. But the scriptures would tell us different. James 4:3 says, "When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, so that what you get can just be for you." Even hearing the voice of God, even having God speak to you in your life is not just for you. It's for his glory first. We get the blessing from it, but it is for him. Authenticity opens up the lines, but inauthenticity will close up the lines for God to speak to us. Another hindrance is indifference. Indifference. Another way of saying this would just be a lack of expectancy. Many of us have lost our expectancy that God would even speak to us. Maybe it's because you got frustrated because you felt like it's just been so long. Maybe you're just apathetic. You just think, it's not that big a deal. I don't need to hear from God. My bills are paid. My family's good. I got a good job, got money in the bank, my IRA's doing good. I'll see you when I get to heaven, Jesus. Not really concerned about hearing from him, but that is a dangerous place to be. To be indifferent about hearing God's voice is dangerous because he wants to impart things to us all the time. He wants to guide us and direct us. To think it's so arrogant to think that we can just live our life and guide our own life without being directed by him and without surrendering and submitting ourselves to him and to his leading in our life. Because he has a plan for you. And it's not just to do what we think we need to do. He's put you on this earth for a reason, to be a light for his kingdom, to be a light to other people that need to know, to be his ambassador to a dying world. This is easily one of the biggest traps for us as Christians, just to be indifferent. And I love what A.W. Tozer said about this subject. He said, the one that doesn't expect God to speak will discount every single time he does speak. If we don't expect it, we won't hear it when we hear it. We might hear it, but we're not tuned in and listening. And listen, it's normal to go through seasons where you're more expectant than you are in other seasons. I've had those myself. I've even had recently where I felt rebuked because I didn't feel like I was really expecting God to speak much to me or to illuminate his word to me. I've been in a season where, the Bible says God gives grace to the humble. So in humility, I'll tell you guys, reading my Bible lately has been a labor. I have times where I love to read it and I can just sit here for hours and read it and just devour it. And I have times just like everybody else where I'm reading it and it's a challenge to get through it. And as soon as I'm done, I forgot what I read. And I don't feel like God's illuminating anything to me. And I'm reading stuff and I'm asking God. See, I've been doing this long enough to know that you do go through seasons like this in life, but I've also been doing it long enough to know that I need to ask him to stir my heart, to not let myself become indifferent to where I just don't care. Okay, trusting him is not the same thing as being indifferent. I trust him, but I'm still saying, God, I really want you to speak. I really want you to stir me. I really want fresh fire in my life. I want to be excited about you. Stir me up, God. We can all become dormant. We need to be stirred, and God's the one that stirs us. Ask the Lord to stir us. It's important that we stay faithful during those times and not stay at a place of indifference. You see, we can feel sorry for ourselves when we feel like we haven't heard from God in a while. You know, like, oh, God's just hiding from me. I don't know why. And we can kind of go into this self-pity mode, you know, and eventually you just kind of become indifferent to it. But can I tell you today a truth that's so good is that God is always moving, but he's never hiding. God doesn't hide from his people. A shepherd does not hide from his sheep. Sheep, because the shepherd knows the sheep need him. You know, we're referred to as sheep in the Bible, and you know, there's a reason for that. Sheep are, I don't want to use the D word, but they're not very intelligent. And they're helpless. A sheep has zero defense to a predator. Zero. Unless there's a shepherd there to help. And your shepherd knows that. So he's not hiding from you. You may not sense him as much as you do sometimes as you do in others, but he's never hiding. And we have to pray that we never give up. We never just settle into a place of dormant. We never settle into a place of indifference. Always asking God to keep stirring our hearts. Because if you stay there long enough in a place of indifference, you progress to a place of being calloused. And can I tell you, being calloused is very, very dangerous. The calloused people were the ones Jesus rebuked the most when he was on earth. Those were the religious ones. They did all the religious duties. They did everything right that was supposed to be done outwardly, but their hearts were calloused. In fact, in Matthew 13, Jesus calls them out. He says, for this people's hearts have become calloused. And look, they can hardly hear with their ears because they've become so calloused. They've closed their eyes. Otherwise, they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn, and I would heal them. You know, calluses, if you've ever done blue collar work, you know calluses are a good thing on your hands, right? Or if you play guitar, calluses on the end of your fingers is a good thing. Right, I used to play guitar a lot. I had calluses on my fingers. Then when I had played after I hadn't picked up a guitar in 10 years, after 30 seconds, they were almost bleeding. It hurt so bad I couldn't play. Calluses are a good thing because if you got calluses and you're handling a shovel all day and you're digging, the calluses keep you from hurting, right? If you go out and you have a desk job and you go out and dig a ditch in your backyard with a shovel after about 30 minutes, you're getting some blisters and you're hurting. But the same thing that makes calluses great on your hands is what makes it so dangerous on your heart. Because when it's on your hands, you can't feel the pain. But your heart's supposed to be able to feel that pain. Your heart's supposed to be able to, it's supposed to be sensitive to the fact that something's not right. I'm not hearing from God. I don't feel passionate about God. I feel like I'm going through the motions. That should be something that alerts us and alarms us. But when we become callous, we're just used to it. We don't care. So calluses on the heart are some of the most dangerous things you can have in your life because you just stay at a place of indifference. And that is not what God has for any of us. He designed us to want him to speak to us. He's designed it that way. He says, my sheep listen to my voice and they follow me. Don't stay at a place of indifference. And then third and finally, inaction. Inaction will hinder us from hearing God's voice. See, here's the thing. God does speak. And when he does speak, the responsibility for us is to act on it. It is vitally important that when he speaks, that we obey. See, for some of us, if we were to say, you know, God hasn't spoken to me in a long time, maybe it's been weeks, months, years since you feel like God's really spoken to your heart, showed you something, really illuminated something that you knew was for you. Maybe it's been a long time. Can I tell you this today? And I don't say this judgmentally, but to alert us if we need it, that maybe the last time God spoke to you, you didn't obey. Maybe. You see, the Bible's clear. Galatians 6 tells us that God won't be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. We reap what we sow. So if God speaks to you and there's an action required with that and you don't do it, you're not sowing obedience. What makes you think you're going to reap more of the voice of God in your life? You reap what you sow. So if you sow inaction, you're going to reap inaction. Because God has called us to respond when he speaks to us. Obedience today can open up doors for tomorrow. Just like disobedience today can close doors tomorrow. And that includes hearing from God in our life. It is not something to be taken lightly. When you feel like God has spoken something to you, it is imperative that we act on it, that we walk it out, that we walk in obedience to what he has said. He doesn't speak just for the fun of it. It's to give us the guidance we need. It's to give us the direction we need. Sometimes it's to convict us. Do you know the conviction of the Spirit is as much the voice of God as anything else you'll ever experience in your life? If you've ever had a time where you knew when you did something that God was displeased and you knew you needed to ask his forgiveness, that was the voice of the Lord speaking to you. Because there's nothing else in the universe that wants you to be convicted of sin besides the Spirit of God. He's the only one. So if you've been convicted in your life, you've experienced the voice of God. I don't know how you grew up. I don't know. Maybe you were told, you know, God doesn't speak anymore. He doesn't do that. The only way he speaks is through his Bible. And if you want to hear the audible voice of God, you just read the Bible out loud. I've heard that plenty. But let me tell you something. That is minimalizing the voice of God. Because let me tell you something. If you're saved today, you didn't get saved unless you heard the voice of God. That's the only way to do it. The way we get saved is by the Spirit drawing us. Like I said, so many people like to mystify it, and people have abused it. People have made it into something wacky. It's not wacky. But God speaks to us all the time. He guides us all the time. How many times can you look back and say, man, it's obvious that the Lord had his hand on me there because of how that whole situation worked out. You didn't even recognize it in the moment, but you know he spoke to you. You know that you were led by him. It's because of the voice of God in your life. But man, too often I think we want to just sit and wait for this cataclysmic moment, the booming James Earl Jones voice that's got to be God, right? That's just so authoritative and deep and it has to be him. We want the pillar of fire. We want the burning bush. We want the fleece that's wet and then it's dry. But a lot of times it's the still small voice that's guiding us. And sometimes it's the voice behind you. Did you know that? Isaiah 30 is a really good verse about hearing the voice of God. This is the Lord speaking through the prophet Isaiah in verse 21. It says, your ears shall hear a word behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. When you turn to the right or when you turn to the left. This is really good because this is one of the ways the Lord speaks. He's saying here that when you're moving and you turn to the right or the left, you'll hear something behind you saying, no, this is the way, or this is the way, walk in it. So that tells me we can't just be inactive in our faith, that sometimes you won't hear the Lord until you step out. Sometimes we just want to sit and wait and have God clear the path for us and show us exactly what to do. And sometimes he's saying, actually, I need you to step out. And when you go, you're going to hear my voice behind you say, no, go this way. Because oftentimes we say we want to hear the voice of God. We want to hear him speak to us before we do what we think we're going to do. And it's not really that we just want to hear him. It's really that we just are in fear. And I'm not willing to trust him to step out. But there's a lot of times he says, no, I want you to step out. And when you do, you'll hear me behind you. But if I can confuse you, which that's not my goal, but this might. Sometimes he says, be still and know that I'm God. Oh, thanks for confusing us, Pastor. I appreciate that. But here's what I'm getting at is there's no formula. It's not, oh, this is how it is every time. Oh, you just need to step out in faith. Oh, you want to quit your job because you don't like it? Oh, just step out. Quit. But sometimes God will say, yeah, you need to step out in faith and quit. You got to be able to listen to the voice. You have to tune in to his voice. And can I tell you, hearing the voice of God in your life takes practice. It takes a lot of practice. I have missed it horribly in my life. I can give you just as many examples of where I thought it was God and it wasn't as I can of times when I thought it was him and it was. And that's okay. Guess what? I'm still standing. I'd rather step out in faith thinking it was God and totally miss it than just stand back and wait. Praise God. Stand with me, please, church. I want to pray for us. I want you to believe today. Maybe some of you have had a hard time believing that you can hear God. I want you to put that aside today and ask God to help you to believe. And to, you may need to repent for your inauthenticity in your relationship with him. You may need to repent for your inaction or your indifference. One of the greatest aspects of our God is that when we come to him and repent, when we turn away from whatever that was, we know that every single time he forgives us and cleanses us. It's not about being perfect. It's about having a pure heart before him. You can hear from God. And you probably have heard from God. I would encourage you today, if you got a spouse or a good friend that you could talk to today, just say, hey, when sometime you've heard from God in your life? And then just share back and forth when you've heard from God. And you'll be amazed how many times you can come up with where you're actually like, yeah, that actually was God. That's really cool. It stirs us. It gets rid of that indifference. It causes us to action. Don't miss out on that moment. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you today for your word. God, we thank you that you are the good shepherd and that you love your sheep and that you speak to your sheep and your sheep listen to you. God, we want to be sheep that listen. We want to hear you, God. We want to walk out where you lead us. Lord, thank you for your promises in our life. God, I pray for those in this room and the watching online that have had promises from you that they have allowed to die, that have gone dormant, that they've given up on. God, would you rekindle those promises today in their life? In Jesus' name. Stir them up, Lord. Because God, we know that there are times you give us promises that it gets worse before it gets better. That we're gonna go through seasons where it's gonna feel like it's not gonna happen. There's absolutely no way it could happen. God, remind them that you are faithful. Your name is faithful. You can't not be faithful. It's not even possible. So God, help us to stand on your word, to stand on your truth and trust you, God. We repent for where we have allowed apathy, indifference, inaction, inauthenticity to come into our life, God. We turn from that today, God, and we are expectant and we trust you. You are awesome. You are amazing. We love you. We thank you for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for saving us, for cleansing us from all unrighteousness. We honor you today, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Amen.